No matter how sick of it, they always kept the pace.
When the rapids were over and no waterfalls were left, they returned to the river very tired and bereft. It was there in the distance that they saw their next affront.
Yes, the vast Rocky Mountains they would soon have to confront.
They were told the Shoshones were the Indians to find.
Sacagawea's tribe that she had left behind.
They would give them the horses that would carry all their stuff,
cause ascending the Rocky Mountain range would be enough.
There in the wilderness, they finally found the noble tribe. They felt such happiness, but none more than their guide.
Sacagawea felt the light of disbelief
when she found that her brother had become the chief.
She tried to contain herself and translate all they said,
but at times she would cry with joy and hug the chief instead.
Horses were traded for clothing, guns, and many knives. Traveling with the corps, the horses saved their lives.
And you know what's next, Mel?
Onward through the Rocky Mountains.
Hard to imagine anyone actually crossing the Rockies on foot.
Now, the Native Americans have crossed the Rockies many times. And Lewis wrote in his journal, "I feel perfectly satisfied that if the Indians could pass these mountains with their women and children, then we could do so as well."
Oh. Wait a minute, let me get a foothold here.
But you're standing on my head.
Well, it's the only solid thing that's going to give me the support. With the horses from the Shoshones and direction from their guide, they ascended the Rockies on a most ambitious ride.
When they came to the Bitter Roots on the Continental Divide, there were steep cliffs and narrow chutes. It's amazing they survived.
The horses kept tripping and temperatures dipping the more that they rode. It was sleeting and snowing and adventure was slowing. They all nearly froze.
All their food depleted, they had no more resource.
Their spirits so defeated, they had to eat a horse. They ate one of their horses?
Along with candles, bear oil, and that awful dehydrated soup.
What did they do then?
They kept climbing to the highest point in the Rockies.
Keep going, Lewis. You can do it.
I don't know, Park. Oh. The air is just so thin up here. I can hardly breathe.
Wait. Lewis, look. We made it. We're at the top of the mountain.
Look, down there at the Bitterroot Valley. Come on, Park. It's all downhill from here. In all, it would take the Corps 53 days to cross the Rockies.
Of course. After all that time, Lewis found out there was another way through the mountains that should have taken them only 4 days.
Shh. Lewis kept this information to himself so as not to disappoint the rest of the Corps.
Good idea. When they finally descended, bad luck didn't end. It remained very high.
They went to find meat or whatever to eat, but they all came up dry.
Camping near a creek, they called it hungry.
Everyone so weak, but then,
what did they see?
Wait, Lewis, look!
What is it?
Down there in the valley, it's a tribe of Indians!
Well, let's hope they're as friendly as most of the other tribes we've met.
We're too desperate to worry about that.
As it turned out, they didn't have to worry because the Indians were the very friendly Nez Perce.
Nez Perce? That's French for pierced nose.
That's right. Most of the Nez Perce had pierced noses. And later, they encountered the Wenatchee Indians. They were one of the Flathead tribes.
Hey, no fair calling them names.
No, they really had flat heads. Now you see, they would press their babies' heads between two boards until they were permanently flat.
Why would they do that?
Well, to make themselves look more beautiful that way. In fact, many of the Western tribes distorted their bodies for beauty's sake. Tattoos, binding feet until they swelled, and putting all sorts of things, like seashells, through their pierced noses.
Whoa! Leave it up to the trendy people on the West Coast to think of gnarly things like that, dude.
And then one day, the Corps came across Native Americans wearing U.S. sailor jackets, and they knew they must be close to their destination.
And on November 18th, 1805,
1 year, 6 months, 2 weeks, and 3 days after the start of their journey,
Lewis and Clark and the Corps of Discovery finally reached their destination. Without a fanfare, there seemed to come from nowhere a vision that touched each traveler's soul. There in the distance, after much persistence, 4,000 miles they had gone to see the sight they counted on, the ocean that had been their ardent goal, the Pacific. Like the vastness of their dreams, how terrific! All their struggle it redeems, through rocks and storms and so much more, the waters join to reach the shore and greet the travelers with a rousing cheer. The core of discovery is here.
Onward to our grand finale.
It was Lewis, and many more that knew us, and all the friendly native tribes we met. William and Meriwether brought the core together to reach the goal that Jefferson had set.
Captain Clark, your handiwork if you please, sir. Yes, running out of St. Charles, Missouri, up the muddy Missouri River. And the Great Plains, buffalo, prairie dogs, and the evil Bitterroot range of the Rocky Mountains. And finally, Fort Clatsop and the Pacific Ocean.
There she is, ghosts. They extended the commerce of our nation.
They explored all of the lands the maps had shown.
They unearthed many new forms of nature, and they claimed the land they traveled as our own. So, come one, come all, to a land that will enthrall, with teamwork and diversity, with courage and the will to be, a nation that responded to the call, and now should be a land that welcomes all.